Right, so when I was recording the video taking apart the instrument cluster, I actually realized that I left my mic off. So some of this video is going to be basically dubbed over, so my hand movements and things won't necessarily correlate with what I'm saying. But I've re-recorded the audio essentially, and so I can then still edit the video together and you can understand what's going on. But I just thought I'd explain that. Otherwise, it might seem slightly confusing, obviously. If I say something and I'm not pointing at it, and obviously, there also won't be the sounds of clattering tools and things as I'm working on things, but it's not too big a deal. And I just thought do a little video to say that. Right, so we've got our instrument cluster there, and I'm just going to show you what tools you need to take it apart and fix the cogs basically within the odometer drive. Now you may question some of them, and I'll go through and explain them. So we've got a pair of circuit pliers there. They can be helpful, you may not need them, you probably won't need them. I've just got them as a precaution basically, and I'll explain why and when I'm using them, if I even use them. There's a knife. Now again, that's going to confuse people. Basically, knife can be used to just part the speedometer apart, so a knife can be helpful. That's also again why the fork's there. It depends which tool I feel like using basically, and at this point they're tools, not utensils. So it depends which one I feel like using. You want something a large flat area and to be able to pry with. The knife's about obviously a very large flat area, but then the because the fork's got the prongs that are close together, but far enough apart to actually be useful, so it can be quite good to use that rather than using flat-bladed screwdriver where you've only got a small flat area, whereas both of these have large flat areas. We've also got then slightly more obvious tools of pliers. You should only use one type. I've just got both types out just as a kind of you can use either, and I'll probably end up switching between both. I've got a couple of cross-head screwdrivers here, Phillips screwdrivers, whatever. Again, shouldn't need one of them, but I've got both just because I have, because I'm just happen. And then I've got two different flathead screwdrivers. They should both be fine. I should be able to use either, but again, it's handy to have options, so I've got both of them laid out. For the moment, the only things we really need to use are the one of the crosshead screwdrivers and one of the flathead screwdrivers. That's all we really need at the moment. To initially take the main bulk of the clocks apart.
Alright, so the first thing that we're going to need to do is we're going to need to remove the two plugs, or the two sockets, so these two. Nice and simple, really. All you need to do is just pry them up. Most thing to do is get a screwdriver and a small flat blade, carefully pry it up from the bottom, and then push it up, and it will just pop off. It's really quite simple, and yeah, just pop them both off. Right, so the next thing you need to remove is these bulb holders. I mean, you can do it by hand, but it's obviously a lot easier to use a pair of pliers just because of it's quite tight. So there's three of them. One of them on the back. One here, one here. So just grip them carefully, give them a 90-degree twist, and they then just pop out. Nice and simple. What you also want to do, you want to make sure you're careful with them because if you smash those bulbs, then you're going to need to replace the whole piece because you can't really easily replace the bulbs because they're a pain. As you see, you can do it by hand, so that middle one comes out by hand. So next up, we need to remove this circuit board. I say circuit board, but it's thin plastic. But anyway, just to just pop that off there, out of the way. And then we can flip it around, and then everything else we need to do is these screws. So we've got the 8 screws in total, 4 across the top, 4 across the bottom. We also then have a couple of other bits we need to remove, and we only need to remove one half of the instrument cluster for the fix that I'm doing. So that's all we're going to really focus on, is removing this bit. You can remove it all, but for what we're doing, we're only moving half of it. And so that's got the speed sensor here, speed for the digital speedo. And so there's a couple of screws that need to pull that out, and then there's a little flat blade screw at the top here for the transistor and the not metal plate. So there are some other screws and things which we shouldn't need to remove, because they just hold the circuit board onto the rest of the units. I say we'll just take all the screws out for the bits on the speedo drive that we don't want. Cool. And then we've got, there's a couple of pegs that hold the plastic circuit board or the film circuit board onto the unit, so just carefully just pop that off. And then we've got a plug at the top. So the plug at the top, okay, if we just spin it around, easy to see. It's easy enough to remove, but it's there, just in the top of the PT unit. And so what we then need to do is just carefully use a flat blade screwdriver if you're very careful with it. Or if you're brave and careful, you can just pry it off by hand. So I'm just carefully prising it up a little bit with the screwdriver, and then I'll just do the rest by hand. Okay, so that's, you can see that's not loose. So we can see if we can move the unit, but we can't quite move the unit because the centre plastic is in the way. So as you can see, it's only wobbling a little bit. So what we need to do is we need to undo the, don't necessarily need to remove, just undo the other four screws. Okay, so it gives a bit more space, so that we can then just pull the board out of the way again, and then we can just pull the drive unit out. Right, so the first thing we need to do is we need to lift the needle carefully over the little rest pin. Now you don't want to do it too hard, because otherwise you might end up snapping the pin. But just be careful. And as you can see, when it actually comes to rest, it comes to rest at the little white marker here at the bottom of the thing. That's where it actually rests, and this is why this is where the difference between the 160, 120 and 140 mile an hour clocks are. Basically the spring in the back, which I'll be showing you later, that's what actually determines the speedo type. Obviously the faceplate as well, but it's the spring in the back that actually does it. Right, the next thing we need to do is remove the needle here itself. Now, you can't actually just prise it off with your fingers, you will need to use some form of tool. There are various suggestions online. You can use a knife. If you've got two hands free, you can use a knife. Obviously, because I'm holding it up to the camera, I can't really use a knife. But basically, you'd use the knife either side of the central pin, and you'd carefully prise it up. Because I don't have that, I'm going to use a fork. And again, carefully though, just wiggle it and prise it up, and try and keep it flat whilst I'm prising it up, so that I can then just gently pop it off and apply even pressure, essentially. And there we go, it's come off. Okay, so the next thing to remove is the two screws that hold the faceplate on. It's using a thin screwdriver and flat blade, and just be careful not to scratch your faceplate, but again, it's just a case of undoing the screws, nice and quick and easy. And then just carefully lift it off over the reset pin. Okay, so that little brass bit in the middle is the spring, this here. This is the spring that determines which speedo you've got, essentially. Obviously the faceplate visually determines it, but this determines where the needle sits in regards to your speed on that dial. Now, basically it's three different power springs. One of them works for 120, one of them works for 140, one of them works for 160. And essentially, spring pressure or resistance then being fed by the central pin allows the needle to move at the right amount to point at the right speed. So the actual, all the drive unit behind is all the same across all of the units, provided they're all VDO units anyway. So all the drive units are the same. It's literally just that spring that determines the difference. All right, so what we're going to do first before we do remove the spring is just remove all four screws. So what you notice is you actually can't remove the bit with actually the odometer reading and the trip computer without actually removing the brass lump that the spring attaches to. So what we need to do is we need to very carefully prise it off. So what I prefer to use is a very small flat blade screwdriver and just carefully lever it from each side essentially. There we go, so now it's free. So now we can actually remove the odometer drive unit, and we can then inspect the cogs that actually count the unit up, and also the speedo drive itself, the drive unit itself, that accepts the speedo cable in the back. Now on mine that appears to be spinning fine, so I don't think there's an issue with that. But the lower cog doesn't seem to be great. It does appear to be moving, but doesn't seem to be moving very well, so there could be an issue with that one. And the condition of the cog that sends the drive up to the odometer counter does seem a bit poor, really. So as already mentioned, this white cog doesn't appear to be in particularly good condition, so I feel that I should probably replace it. I have a couple of spare sets of clocks, so I can take some parts out of one of those ones to actually rebuild this one. And what I also noticed was the cog in the bottom. Below the speedo sensor seems to be okay, speedo drive itself, but this cog here doesn't appear to be in very good condition either. And again, because I've got a spare set of clocks, I can actually use bits from one of the other ones. And I think the main issue though is actually this red cog here isn't making contact with the white cog, the one that doesn't look very good. So I don't think it's making very good contact, so I feel that the best option is actually to replace the whole unit, the whole of the odometer unit, and then fit that into my current speedo housing. And I feel that's probably the most sensible way of going ahead with this. Right, so as quite often like the Haynes manual says, it's refitting is a reverse of removal. So you plug the odometer counter back onto the top of the speedo drive, having made sure that you've got all the cogs and everything back in place as well. And make sure that cog does connect with the red cog does connect with the white cog. And then what we're going to do next is just put all the screws in and do all of those up. So what we're then going to do is make sure that the brass lump with the speedo spring is on the speedo pin. As we carefully place it on there, and push down gently until the spring itself is level with the spring base. If it goes too far, it's not too big a worry. You very carefully get your screwdriver and lever it up gently. Okay, so with that level, we can then place the faceplate back on, the dials, whatever you want to call it, and then put the screws back in. Again, be careful, make sure you don't slip off the screws and end up scratching it or anything. Okay, so with all the screws in, what we can then do is we can then replace the needle. Now, I have to make sure we line it up with this little white mark again, the same as when we removed it, basically. So the best way, so obviously we can place it on there and see if it lines up. It may not line up quite right. First off, it's easy enough to just pull it off and realign it again. And what you don't want to do is you don't want to place it on against the rest pin, because as you can see, that then doesn't return back down to 10 miles or 0 miles an hour, whatever. So you have to make sure you put it against the white mark so that when it's moving, it actually comes back down and rests against the pin correctly. Now, refitting the needle can take a little while to get it lined up correctly, so just keep taking it off, give the unit a shake, when you put it on there, just keep taking it off, putting it back on again, seeing how well it works. What you want it to do basically is when you move it about, you want it to actually end up resting at that little white mark again. Okay, so you can see that I've lined up with the white mark. Giving it a little shake, and it seems to stay lined up with it. And so what I can do is carefully push it back so it's nice and solid. You give it a little tug and it's not going to come off. And then you just basically very carefully lift the needle over the rest pin, and as you can see then as I'm flicking it, it's returning down to the pin correctly. And so then we can get the instrument cluster unit back, peel the circuit board out of the way, and then not drop it like I did. We can peel the circuit board out the way, and then refit the clock unit, and then we can just put all the screws back in and rebuild it and refit it to the car. I'm not going to document how to fit it all back together again and how to fit it all back to the car and test it and everything, because it is literally, as the Haynes manual would say, it is the reverse of removal. It's all very simple, really. Just take your time, carefully plug everything back in again, and then put all the screws back in the correct order, correct places, correct order and everything, and you shouldn't have any issues.